to you. Welcome to another News Make Alive broadcast right here on DBS Television. My name is Timothy Polian. We go up until 10 o'clock this evening, at which time we'll be concluding with the clip that peaked. We are about 2 minutes early this evening, and that's a rarity. Thank you so much for joining the broadcast. Well, something happened on Sunday evening. It caught many people by surprise. I'm sure that would have caught by surprise as well the officials of the Folk Research Center, which is located at Mount Pleasant. And the building was gutted by fire and artifacts destroyed in a blaze that certainly would have been to the consternation of many people on the island. This certainly would have also taken an emotional toll on the staff and management of that institution, which has been in existence since 1973. The main objectives of the FRC: to promote research in St. Lucia's culture, to explore and clarify the role of culture in the development of our people, and also to contribute to the cultural development of our people. Will a phoenix rise from the ashes? We'll be discussing this issue, looking at the future of the Folk Research Center, where it's at right now, and what kind of toll this has taken on its work, and what the future holds for this institution. Joining the broadcast is the executive director of the Monsignor Patrick Anthony Folk Research Center, Mr. Hilary LaForce. And also on the broadcast, we are joined by Juliana Prosper. Welcome to the program.
Thank you very much.
Let's start with you, Mr. LaForce, as the executive director of the Folk Research Center. How do you feel at this time, being at the helm of an institution which has gone through that kind of experience?
Totally devastated. When I got the call at about 10:30 on Sunday evening, someone had said that the Folk Research Center building was on fire. And I said to myself, it might be an error. And from where I live, I can see the entire city, including the Folk Research Center. I didn't take a look out there, because I told myself I'm in denial. I don't think that's correct. But I headed down to the place. I passed through Le Clery, the back, so I've not seen nothing at all, absolutely nothing. But when I got to the entrance, I saw there was policemen. Then I was convinced that there is something wrong. And the policeman who recognized me said, you can go ahead, whereas other traffic was denied entrance. And when I got to the place, I saw this inferno. It was heartbreaking. I couldn't hold back the tears to say, but look at this. This is an organization that had been established for 45 years in a structure that epitomizes our St. Lucian culture. And heritage go up in flames. And even though we try to rebuild, it may not be the same thing anymore. At the same time, I'm thinking, but look, we are just running an after-school program for children at risk. Where we would continue that program? The children who had basically adopted a new home. And even to the extent that some, about less than 2 years ago, a stray dog apparently was left by some of the owners. The dog came around. And we adopted the dog. And the dog is actually our dog. It knows everybody's coming in business and who's coming to loiter. And it'll run down anybody who's coming to loiter in the place.
Is it a white dog?
A white dog.
Yeah, because I visited the scene of the fire on Monday morning. Mm-hmm. And it was remarkable that the dog stood out. It was the only being on the premises there at the time.
Very well.
Yeah.
We call the dog happy. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking, but look, that can't be right. That can't be true. But the reality was there. The building was on fire. So quickly had to run, had to call, make some call. The first person I called was the founder, Monsignor Patrick Anthony. When I said to him, I have bad news. And he said, what? And I said, FRS is on fire. He said, what? And he stopped for a while. Then I realized, obviously, he was shocked. Mm-hmm. And I said, okay, I'll talk to you again. And I went to calling other people. And I could not hold back the tears. It was very emotional, at the same time, very, very devastating. Because look, in this building, there are lots of information. We had a plethora of books, political files, information that would not, we can't replace.
We'll explore that in just a moment.
Yes.
But Juliana Prosper, what was your reaction when you heard that the FRC was on fire on Sunday evening?
Tim, I had just turned off my phone because, you know, after a long day, you shut your phone down so you could go sleep. But I kept hearing this buzzing. I said, no, that must be a call coming through. So when I picked up the phone, I recognized it was another friend of ours, who used to be a board member, Alan Regis. I said, why is Alan calling me at that time? And he said, FRC is on fire. All I said was, Alan, you lie. He said, yes. I said, Alan, you lie. So when I looked at my phone, I recognized I had missed calls from him and different persons. All I said to my son was, drop me at Folk Research Center. I can't tell you what I put on me because I was ready to go to sleep. When I got to the bottom, I told the officer, well, I'm a board member. He said, go, but come back. Let my son come back. When I began climbing the hill and I saw the inferno, Tim, all I think I froze, and my son is telling me, mommy, mommy, and I could not, like, it was all in a daze. This was not what I was seeing. And as I got closer, I saw Mr. LaForce. I looked at Mr. LaForce. I don't think I said a word to him at the time because I could not speak. And I just kept walking closer to the fire. My son, he said, but mommy, you walking, you going into, so the officer said, I stood up, I cried. Then I said, where's Happy? Happy was in the bush. When I called him, he came, I patted him, and he went back to lie down. And I just kept walking, and then everybody else came, and we're having this conversation. But Tim, it did not register. It just could not register.
You think you were in a state of shock?
Surely it was. Surely.
It was. Because that would be the last thing you would expect to, you know, knowing you just left there the Friday, you had your program, you knew what you were coming for, you know, the Monday, you'd prepare the children, your class for Monday, your items are already spread out, the children had just completed an item, and we had a visitor coming to us today from, you know, USAID, and we were just ready and going, and I, you know, and up to now, I am still overwhelmed. All I want to do is just cry.
This loss is akin to what, Mr. LaForce?
It's almost like four generations of persons have perished. Because we're talking, we have amassed four generations of information on the life of St. Lucia.
Yeah.
Because when people talk about culture, some people believe it's only La Hawes and La Marguerite. It's more than that. Mm-hmm. It's a way of life of our people. The way they behave, the way they do things, the way they survive with each other. And all this was recorded in that particular building. Okay? Recently, somebody called me and said, look, I'm doing an SBA with my son, and I want to know what is the National Tree of St. Lucia. And first thing came to me was, check with the Forestry Division. But then I called my librarian and said, could you get some information on this? And sure, it was there. The Calabash tree, and what year it was declared the national tree. We had all this information out there. Just mention anything and think of the life of St. Lucia. Yeah, we have it all there, both in print and in audio video. We have almost 2,000 hours of audio video material. Of course, it's in the old format, what they call the pneumatic tapes. We're trying to digitize it. We haven't got to this, something we'll talk about. And so, one could help imagine the extent of information that we have lost. And this has jolted almost everybody around the world now, saying, but look, if this has gone down, it can happen to us too. The National Archives, the Government Registry, all this have information, important information that tells about our lives. And as you see, if you don't know your history, you won't know where you're going to.
Imagine that you have appreciated the FRC and the significance of that institution over several years now. But do you feel a sense of loss? Do you even feel that maybe to a certain extent you were even taking its existence for granted now that this has happened?
I will say no. Based on...
You don't believe you could have loved the FRC and the structure even more?
But you see, that's what this was all about. When you begin to understand, you begin to put more of yourself into something. You begin to appreciate, so the love grows stronger. So as you learn, as you delve into the institution, or even into a relationship, you begin to foster that bond. And that was it for me. And my profession made it a lot easier because I have to now teach my children about the culture. So I didn't have a choice but to actually go into the belly of my culture to be able to impart that knowledge to my children. So Tim, it was a love. I do not put my time into something I do not love. And I will give it 110%. And I give FRC 110%. And as Mr. LaForce said at some point, sometime earlier, it was knowledge. You kept on learning about FRC. Because as a board member, you're finding out things. Every time you research. And you realize that institution was blessed with immeasurable knowledge, which our children at the secondary schools, other persons overseas would, but I don't think we as St. Lucians knew exactly what storage of knowledge we had. And I must also say, it's not just about the board members, other persons who gave us the love of their own artifacts, own writings, into the belly of FRC. So it's a loss for all St. Lucians, because we did not build FRC by our own. Our foreparents, grandparents gave us, and that's why we had the capacity of everything at FRC. So it belongs to St. Lucia. And as I'm saying, my profession allowed me the privilege of just going in there and learning and sharing. So it was I cannot even say the past tense yet. Mm-hmm. I keep talking in the present tense. When people call, where are you? I cannot say CDF, I say FRC. And then they look at me and tell me, no, you're at CDF. It's Tim, I am still trying to understand what, I know what I have lost.
But what do you think that the people of St. Lucia and the whole, what they have lost, those who cannot identify with what you are saying there, they don't even understand what you're saying there. They don't understand the significance of that institution.
The sweat, the tears, the hours, the struggle of us, our people. Those before us did a lot. Just think of the clay pot. Imagine we visited there today with the children. My children, they actually wanted to see the building. And when we got their team, they began wanting to go. We had to guide them. And coming out of that burning place, Tim, coal pots, you see the clay? Mm-hmm. In a hole, not any dark, nothing black. You swear you just placed we took the photos. You would swear you just took those clay items and placed it there. And the children went like, Miss, look at the coal pot. Look at the clay pot. And they went and they had to hold it, the vases. And it just made all of us recognize that out of this thing, there is something stronger than us in there. And we cannot forget the persons who introduced us to that, the clay, the dances, the songs, the Margaret, the La Rose, the stories, the history. We have to appreciate that. And if you tell me you do not want to know your history, life is not what it should be.
Because there's white people are in unison. Mourning the if you want to put it so, the loss of the FRC and the structure in particular. Do you think that a sufficient number of St. Lucians really displayed that kind of love for the institution that was needed?
Well, it appears that it's love in destruction. Because the amount of persons that have been calling, and persons you would imagine, are saying, but look, I was there some time ago, and I've taken photographs of the place, so if you want photographs, I have in storage. Some say, I've been out, did the research, and I have research material. If you want, we can replace it, we can let you have it. This is when we realize there are lots of persons, even children. Now, we know there has been the story that we're not able to attract the youth. Not quite true. We run programs particularly during Creole Heritage Month. For an entire month, we have cultural education for schools. And all schools throughout the islands come to the FRC. And they look forward to this. As a matter of fact, on Monday, we are supposed to have some children from Cicero School to come in to learn about the early settlers in St. Lucia. And the next day, the Tuesday, we're having some children from Dong and VFR to come and talk to learn about the games and the early games and so on. And the first thing came to my mind, that's Sunday evening, but wait, where are we going to have these children now? It means that we have lost all of this. Okay? We have begun with some tour guide to start bringing tourists as part of a package to the FRC. And that is, of course, is gone. But generally, it appears that we thought that only a few people knew about the FRC until this tragedy. Then you begin to realize the amount of persons, and not only in St. Lucia, non-St. Lucians outside of St. Lucia, are expressing concern.
How much strength do you draw from this in terms of the rebuilding effort down the road, Juliana? What will it take?
It will take all of us, because we need the assistance of everybody. And I think St. Lucians can be guaranteed that we are ready, and we are ready, and we will do everything in our power. But I think, Tim, what this has allowed us to do is to now embrace all St. Lucians. And we no longer want it to be decisions made by the board members. It now has to be a national consultation as to what St. Lucians want to see FRC become. Yes, we have lost, but I think it's an opportunity now for us to start afresh. And I will always come back to the youth. We need them on board as of now, because we are on our way out, and we need them to know they must take the ship and let's go. But as I'm saying, it is not going to be our decision. It will be a decision by the time we are finished. Everybody would have had an input as to what FRC will become.
Doesn't that set the stage for confusion if everybody
would have because an input? You see, I think what has happened is when you have an institution that is already settled and established, you run with it and you let it happen. But we always wanted, as a board member, to have the youth involved and to have the public have a greater say and greater partnership with FRC. And it has been a struggle, especially when it comes to the membership. And I'm saying doors are now open for us to begin that membership drive, even though we don't have a building, because we keep saying FRC is not the building. Is the spirit that is there. And this is our way to begin afresh with the old, to begin to build the FRC that St. Lucia really deserves.
What is the numbers like in terms of the membership of the Folk Research Center? What is it like right now?
It has dwindled over the years, just about between 25 and 30 persons. Mm. At one time, it was well over 100. But over the years, it has dwindled. And it's not only
that's
for the FRC.
That's not much at all.
And it's not only for the FRC, but generally persons, you know, don't seem to have that kind of a time for organizations. It's the same thing happened to other organizations, okay, where the membership is dwindling. There's one particular sister organization, because of a particular situation, everybody ran back to it, mm-hmm. okay? Mm-hmm. And it might be the situation with the FRC right now.
But what do you think it will take to ensure that you, for lack of a better word, entice people, bring them in? Do you think this tragedy will result in more people wanting to join the organization?
I think so, because if you appreciate your culture, if you say you love it, and when something dies, what do? You're working towards rebuilding, growth, greenness. We don't want the brownness.
But do we really love our culture, or do we gravitate towards anything that has food and alcohol and so on, and then we try to immerse ourselves in it under the guise of loving our culture, Shinekweol and so on.
But then again, it takes me back to the point, is how we approach it and is how we now sell it. How I sell it to you. I know what it was before, and that was not working. So I now have the opportunity to strategize, knowing exactly what I can try now to entice you into that. So it is, we cannot sit back and say it's not going to happen, regardless of what the past is. The past is the past. But we must build on the future. If not, we just put our hands up in air and say we're done. But we must try whatever it takes. Tim, a country without a culture is dead. It's dead. There is no heartbeat. There needs to be a heartbeat. And that is our heartbeat. Regardless, yes, we appreciate the technology and the newness and the modernization. But where is that thing that keeps us going and pumping? That makes me want to say, but yeah.
But Mr. Lafort, there seems not to be any kind of buy-in into the work of such organizations. Why do you think that's the case?
Maybe it's because, look at the demographics. The majority of our people are young people. And to them, they tend to gravitate to outside cultures. And this is a natural phenomenon in every country you go to. Okay, so the fact of television and other media, the youth listen to, you know, cultures of the United States and other countries, even within our region. A lot of our kids listen to the Jamaican reggae and the way of life, all right? And so there's always a thinking that, okay, these are better than ours, and so let's go to it, or let's fashion our way of life to it. But again, that is only one part of it in terms of music and so on. But generally, the way we live, some of our people, sometimes when children come to the folk research, they ask the first thing, what is culture? And some say, oh, it is singing laros, some say it's margarita. Mm. I say, no, it is the way of life of the people. It's the learned way of doing things. And you're able to differentiate people based on their culture.
So then culture is not static?
It's not static, you know, it's dynamic, it changes. While we're trying to have people to appreciate what happened, what our foreparents did, doesn't mean that we go back to this. You can use it as a platform to move on. For example, there are lots of cruel technologies that our foreparents were involved in. As far back as the Amerindians in the making of farine, they used the grater and so on. Today, we wouldn't tell people to grate farine for grates anymore. You can use some machine to grate the farine to extract the moisture from it. You can use a centrifuge. Before, you had to put it on this, what they call a press with a heavy stones on it. Mm-hmm. You can move away from this. But using this technology out there to build on it to improve all, you know, the steps and to ensure it's much better and more efficient. So while we say to them, well, look, this is how it was done, it doesn't mean that you must go back to this or that's the way of life. You use that to improve and get better and better.
How's the adjustment been? Now you have some office space at the CDF. How's life been from Monday to today for the staff of the FRC?
We are very thankful for CDF giving us the space. It's not the same, but work has to happen. So, I mean, what do you do? It's a new home. You have to make yourself comfortable. We have the business of our you know, FRC at heart. So we just work every day. We take it one day at a time. We cry if we have to. For example, today we had a counselor to come in to talk to the board members and staff because everybody needs to find a way to express. And it was a very fruitful exercise because we are taking care of our members as well because we're not the only ones suffering. So we found that was a necessary activity. And I must say thanks to Father Anthony for, you know, taking on that initiative. So we are also taking care of our members, our staff, and ourselves as well, because if we don't do it, nobody else is going to do it for us. And as you rightly say, we are the ones in the forefront, so we are ready to take the charge.
How can the FRC be contacted?
Okay. We just put a press statement this afternoon saying that for purpose of business continuity, we are now housed at the CDF. Our telephone number would be the same. Our email address would be the same. All programs of FRC will continue. We have a program, the major program coming up in June. It's called St. Lucia Studies Conference, although we intend to modify it to have like a national conference. Okay, we'll continue with our Creole Heritage Month on Shinekweol. That will continue. We can't stop at all. Of course, there will be little modifications here and there because we don't have the space that we had before. But all programs continue, and what is important, we ensure that all staff are not disadvantaged by this strategy, so everybody continues to be employed.
What about the program for the children? Is very much on?
It's very much on. Mm. Today, we, thanks to National Trust, they gave me the use of Walcott House. And
the children,
yes, mm-hmm. and the children are liking the space. But today we did an outing. As I said, we took them out. They wanted to see the building. And we were treated because we had already promised the Easter egg hunt and everything, because everything was already in place. So they did that. So today was our last day. School is closing. So everybody needs to rest. Mm-hmm. So we said, based on the activity. But as soon as school reopens on the 16th, we're back into the program I must say that's the thing with us. We are committed. We made a commitment based on the grant we got. So we will be working to ensure that we fulfill our agreement. So when school opens on the 16th, come hell or high water, team, it is going to happen. Find the space, do what we need to do, and move on.
We'll be taking a break. And when we come back, my guest will be Monsignor Patrick Anthony. But before that, your final comments.
Final comments. I am a teacher at heart, and I will always preach to the youth and the children. So I'm saying to them, any young person who are out there, we are asking you to reach out to us. You have an idea for us to put out there to entice you to come in to join us. We appreciate that. So find us, as Mr. Lafour said, we are at CDF. Come share your ideas with us, how we can get you into FRC, because you're the ones we need to preach it for us and to sell it.
Thank you so much, Juliana Prosper, for being my guest during this segment of Newsmaker Live. Mr. Hiri Lafour will remain with us. And when we come back, Monsignor Patrick Anthony will be my guest along with Mr. Hiri Lafour. Stay with us. You're watching Newsmaker Live right here on DBS Television. Welcome back. Thank you so much for staying with us during this segment. We are joined by Monsignor Patrick Anthony, founding member of the Folk Research Center, and still on the program is the executive director of the FRC, Mr. Hiri Lafour. Monsignor Patrick Anthony, welcome to the program.
Thank you, Tim. Good evening, viewers. We would like to express our profound gratitude for the tremendous outpouring of support that we've had from all quarters. You know, it helped us experience what we always knew, that really FRC is not a building. FRC is in the heart of St. Lucians. FRC is St. Lucian, you know, because FRC is our culture, FRC is our identity, and somehow after 45 years, we try to do that, we try to communicate that, we try to create a consciousness. And I think that, I mean, this tragedy has really manifested that. In fact, the way people have felt, it's a personal loss, you know? Why? Because people have identified the work that we've been doing. So I want to thank you very much for your support, and we hope that now that we are about to relaunch, to rejuvenate, to re-energize, that you will be with us along the way.
Are we a dead hero society, Monsignor Patrick Anthony?
Well, but perhaps it's the what might call the Paschal mystery, you know, that there is no resurrection without death. There is no resurrection without death. You may want to go to heaven, but if you don't die, you have to die, you see? And somehow or other, it always takes a dying for renewal. And what has happened to FRC has happened to St. Lucia. Castries had burned down before, you know? I've said to people, yeah, it's painful, we've lost something, but we can learn. Britain, today England invests billions of dollars in culture. You know why? Because there was the German Blitz, you know? England knows what it is to have been flattened, to have lost everything.
But did we learn anything from the 1948 fire?
Well, the generations that came afterwards, they looked at the building up of the physical structure, the reconstruction of Castries, you see? But the cultural heritage, the knowledge, you see, there was no institution at the time that was really doing what we were doing. Putting together the artifacts, the heritage of country. So really there's nobody to learn from lost in that sense. Huh? I mean, we lost a city and we rebuilt the city. But I'm using the city as a metaphor of the culture. There was no institution like FRC at the time. I mean, we started in
73,
you know. Before that, there was no institution actually doing the kind of work that we're doing.
But Father Anthony, have we failed future generations? Those people, or those youngsters who are looking to us to say, as the repository of our cultural heritage and so on, this is the evidence of what we have secured for you.
Mm-hmm.
We really can't do that, right? Can we? We're not in a position because we were presiding over the Folk Research Center,
mm-hmm.
and it was gutted by fire.
Right.
Does that say something? Does that say something about us and our stewardship? Because I'm sure because of certain deficiencies, that is why we had the fire in the first place.
Oh, yeah, sure. I mean, a few things that we get very clear. FRC is several things. FRC was a repository of data, artifacts, and so on. That's one aspect of FRC's work. FRC was a research center collaborating with international institutions, with students from all over the world. That's another aspect of FRC's work. The research dimension of our work, every institution we partnered with, University of Vienna, for example, came along. They did a 5-year project with us, right? They went around, they did videos, taping, and so forth. And all of that material is at University of Vienna. We had a set of copies here. Ours burnt, but they have their copies. We can retrieve that from them. The Smithsonian Institute has some of the material that have been recorded here. We have copies. They have that. We can recoup that. University of Indiana, the Lomax Collection, we had copies. These are but they're over there. So, you see, you
the audio visual recordings of people like Cecin Descartes, would they have it?
Some of them they would have. Yeah, some of them. So, you see, people figure that FRC is just a building. FRC is not just a building. FRC was a building, yes. We see where those things were important was that for the children who are coming there, I mean, this is where our link with the schools. The schools were coming there all the time, so children could actually see those things, those artifacts, those pictures, those things. But, you know, we have got copies. We can always remake them. We don't have the originals, and that's the tragedy. For example, Harold Simmons' daughter just brought us some original Harold Simmons paintings. Now, we have copies of that. We have photos. We took photos of that. We have digital copies. But the originals are gone, you know?
Mm-hmm.
When we first started, I commissioned Sir Dunstan Santoma to do for us, to capture Derek Walcott's Another Life in painting with the three icons, Derek himself, Harry Simmons, and Sir Dunstan. And we had these three paintings by Sir Dunstan at FRC. We have pictures of them. Originals are gone. You know? So in a way, I mean, we've lost things that are irreplaceable. But we also, the work that we are doing, we also have the capacity to continue the work. Now it's going to be affected. For example, there are students from various universities around the world who are doing their research and their theses with FRC, using our materials at FRC. Now, these students, some of them are halfway through their thesis, ready for the exams and so forth. All of that's affected, you know? So we've lost a lot of stuff, but we can retrieve a lot. And more than that, FRC, as I said, was not just a building. We've lost the actual hard copies, things, and so forth. We're also a research institution. We've had this relationship that continues. We are also a consciousness-raising institution. The raising of consciousness in St. Lucia. This is ongoing, you know. The fact that today people can talk about Creole in a different way from the used to call. It's part of the
world. Except Rick Rina.
you know. The world is not a perfect world, right? Okay. So we always have people, and it's good to have the dialogue with you also.
Mm-hmm.
But the understanding, you know, before, when St. Lucia was, say, in Czechoslovakia, and they met in St. Lucia, they were proud to speak the Creole, mm-hmm. only as a means of identity. Today, Creole is not just that. Creole is an understanding of self. So that now, Juné Creole, for example, the phenomenon of Juné Creole, which is an identity, my traditions, my values, the values like Kudme, all of those values that we got from our ancestors, FRC has been able to promulgate, to perpetuate, to build that consciousness. And that consciousness is in the heart of St. Lucians. That's not in a building. So that's what I mean. So the FRC's work is several dimensions. So that's what we call that our advocacy work. You see?
But is the FRC sufficiently confident in itself, Mr. Harry LaForce, to take advantage of this situation that is happening right now?
Totally confident.
Do you think that it will cower? Do you think it will go out bravely?
Totally confident. In fact, it has strengthened our resolve to do even more. Mm-hmm. Okay? And since the fire from the Monday, we have been on the go, trying to get ourselves. Business continuity is important for us. We need to continue. Persons must understand that FRC is still there. We're not finished with the fire. Okay? We house now temporarily in the CDF building, but we're hoping to establish a building sometime in very soon. But at the same time, we're having consultations. As a matter of fact, this coming Saturday, we're having a consultation with members of FRC and other well-wishers, okay, where we'll be discussing the future. What kind of institution we can now construct, all right? And hopefully, the Friday we'll be inviting people to come around, using cultural norms and so on, music and so on, food. And get persons involved to understand that FRC is still there. We're continuing. We're not dead.
Have you, gentlemen, asked yourself, the question, could this have been prevented? For example, having automatic sprinkler systems, automatic smoke detection? Do you take that into consideration? This could have been prevented.
We've had several proposals, evaluations of FRC, the building done, right? People have told us, look, you guys, you have to get out of there,
yeah.
Because this thing is it's an old building,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's a fire hazard, it's yes. All kind of, yeah. So this is why we knew exactly what we're facing there. This is why we've had digitalization projects, mm-hmm. Sent out to all kind of institutions all around the world, because we know that we have to, we got a subvention from government. Hmm? And the subvention was to try to help us to acquire the property. I mean, we just finished acquiring the property last year. So, whilst we're trying to acquire the property, mm-hmm. we're trying to get the funding to do the important work that we're doing. It's not that you can just say, you pack up and you go somewhere else, And then we have all our programs that we're doing in terms of consciousness raising and so forth. The amount of work FRC has been doing with the limited resources available and the fact that so many people don't consider that a priority, this is why we think that what has happened is such a beautiful, sad experience, because it's a beautiful moment for this nation to recognize that there are certain things that are more important than bread. Man does not live on bread alone. You see, it's not only the bread and butter issues that life is about. And FRC is about the St. Lucia spirit, which is not just bread and butter. And people may want to put money into bread and butter. But when you put money into bread and butter, what happens to you? People die, you see?
Why should the FRC continue to serve as the repository for the nation's cultural heritage?
We are not the only repository for the nation's cultural heritage. I mean, the cultural heritage is broad. For example, the archives,
national
archives. I mean, they are the principal repository of some part of our heritage. You see, mm-hmm. you've got, for example, archaeological and historical science.
Mm-hmm.
They are responsible for another part. Mm-hmm. Where we came in was that we went into the folk cultural heritage.
Yes.
You see, and we approached it in the manner in which the archives and the NH were not doing. We approached it and seen culture as a concept in development, culture as a way of helping a nation to develop itself, not in a materialistic sense, but in a holistic sense. So when FRC came in on the scene, the difference between FRC and the other institutions that existed is that we became an advocacy institution. We became a consciousness-raising institution. We became an institution that was trying to help people to mold their identity. So that was the difference between us. So we're not the only repository of the heritage of St. Lucia. I mean, we're just one of many.
Any word, Mr. LaForce, on the cause of the fire?
No, we're waiting for a report by the Central Fire Services. Our first impression was probably it's an electrical fault. But there's no guarantee that this is what happened, all right? Some persons are suggesting arson. Again, we cannot say that's not, we can't dismiss everything.
Mm-hmm.
So it's only after we get that report we can decide, this is exactly what happened.
Was the building insured?
Yes.
To the tune of how much?
1.25 million.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So you can take some courage in that, because the fact that it was insured, and many structures in St. Lucia are not insured. So then people have been going cap in hand, asking for assistance and so on to reconstruct even their homes and other buildings and so on. In this particular case, it was insured, and therefore you're looking forward to reconstruct the building as soon as when?
Well, you see, the whole question about reconstructing building. I mean, this morning I heard a very, very interesting, I think the president of the ITC...
Association.
Mm-hmm. I mean, he was raising some of the issues that we have been talking about. Because, you see, since Maria, when we see places like Tortola, those places that Barbudan, those places, mm-hmm. Dominica, these places lost a lot of their material. Mm-hmm. So now we are in a different dimension, you know. We have to talk about location, as you're saying. Mm-hmm. I mean, look at where the archives are. It just takes one plane crash, you know. Mm-hmm. One plane crash. And the heritage of St. Lucia, in terms of mm-hmm. our civil register and those kind of things like that, can be gone. Now, we know for years and years, the archives have been trying to get money to digitize and so forth. And try to get multiple. This has not been done yet. So we are hoping that, you see, what has happened to the FRC raises a conversation at that kind of level. So it's not just a question about rebuilding. Mm-hmm. It's a question about location, about kind of structures we're going to put on. It's a big, big, big discussion, and that is why our Lucia Studies Conference, which we were planning for June, in terms of our normal business, will now be transformed into a national discourse on St. Lucia's heritage and memory, storage, preservation, and things like that, you know?
So the current location you think is not appropriate?
We don't know. I mean, we have to discuss and talk about that. You see? Because we look at several things. You have to look at the concept now is a very vast concept. I mean, at Mount Pleasant was an ideal position for many, many things. You know, we've been looking at the concept of Castries as a modern city. Now, when you think of Castries as a modern city, you think of cities like Greece, Athens, mm-hmm. Where you've got the Acropolis, the Parthenon on one hill. We're looking at Castries and that kind of concept. You've got Government House, one area there. You've got Mount Pleasant. We've got FRC and the Cultural Center. Now, we have to look and see now, how are we going to develop Castries to really embrace the kind of modern perspective? And this is why we saw, and we've been trying with government to acquire the entire property, so that could have become a heritage park, where there's no green space for children in around Castries.
What is the response from the authorities?
Well, in fact, with the last government, we had reached a point where we are actually in the negotiating with the with the owners, mm-hmm. to see if government would facilitate the acquisition of the property for us, mm-hmm. so that we could be able to do that, right? Mm-hmm. Of course, the last government went out, and a new government is in, and then we've not even begun the conversation as yet, because there are so many things government doing. Mm-hmm. But the vision that we had was that, you know, this the government house up there, mm-hmm. that's one more. Like you did Rome, you've got the same mountain of Rome. We've got in Castries, so you've got Mount Pleasant there. You've got government house at the mall over there. You've got, you know, so that idea. And for us particularly, what we're looking at is that if you have an heritage park right there, you've got green space. There's no green space in Castries. You've got a place where parents and children can come. And they can now do like you go Disney World. You can go through. You can actually live the culture, experience through the woods. You can get all our cultural, mythological figures. I mean, we have the concept. We present that concept to several people. We are actually, the ALBA Fund has a proposal, and they were in discussion with us to send an expert to help us in terms of developing that concept, you know? So, I mean, there are many things that this location is beautiful for that. However, we also have to discuss what this guy raised about in terms of, proximity to sea, mm-hmm. Fertility. So in terms of one component of FRC can be over there, you know? Whereas in terms of the actual data, housing and so forth, you know? Another big thing that we do is research. FRC is a place where students from all of college.
Yes, yeah.
Is it all of college?
Yes,
Olaf College. Yeah. Every year, we have about 25 students who come and spend a period of time at FRC physically, use their base to do their own research on FRC and on St. Lucia. For several years, they've been doing that. So you know, we're looking at facilities to house students when they come there. We have international students who are coming down and so forth. We have all of our school students who are all the time. So, you know, so it's not just a place where you have got artifacts. Mm-hmm. It's a much, much bigger institution. But if we didn't know, all these things were happening at FRC.
But Mr. Irilo Force, we're hoping, and I imagine as a society, that 9 days from today, that people will not forget about the importance of the FRC and will not be learning from the unfortunate lessons that, you know, whatever the tragedy, that occurred on Sunday. What can we learn from it over an extended period instead of just, for example, after 9 years, 9 days would have elapsed, let's forget about it totally, as is normally the case.
We are trying to ensure that we keep the fire burning, as it were, okay? Having programs, having discussions, continue with our own programs, getting, of course, as we know, our after-school program is on, and we'll be keep on doing advocacy, ensuring that people continue to remain focused on that important institution called FRC. So it's not a question of, well, as you said before, here is a strategy, but the next one is a hurricane, and we forget about this one. We'll attempt to ensure that persons are educated of what's happening, continue to keep, you know, the thing alive.
In terms of what Monsignor Patrick Anthony said, the long-term plan to integrate the FRC into whatever's happening in Castries, in terms of the heritage and so on, in terms of the government house being undermined, what could happen with the FRC, where can it be located and so on. How soon are you hoping to start the dialogue with central government on this issue?
Incidentally, there was a dialogue just recently, as early as what? Was it Monday or Tuesday? At a cabinet level, and they promised us a building, the old what is called Turning Point building. All right, we've been there to try to take a look at the place. We were able to go in, but this is Harrison, an opportunity to, in other words, they're showing interest in assisting the FRC. Okay, it's a question of whether it's a suitable building for us to continue to enter into it. But there is that dialogue. We've started the dialogue. All right, and they prepared. I think the minister also, the minister of equity, also indicated that he'd like to meet with us at the earliest to have a discussion.
So knowing what you know now, Father Patrick Anthony, and what you heard, I think his name is St. Vale, I think, what you heard from the gentleman from the ICT Association of St. Lucia, you have to take a lot of things in consideration before you say yes to this.
The thing is this, that where FRC goes from now, it's not a question of FRC board and government, it's the people of St. Lucia. Mm-hmm. You know, people understand in their heart that institution, this value. That's why people are grieving like that. Everybody's grieving because there's a loss. So now they have to be involved in that conversation.
People are grieving now, but were they celebrating the FRC before?
Well, you see, the thing is this. It took, when we first started with FRC, it took us almost 20 years before people took on FRC. You know? Because FRC is just a few power and a few people doing their nonsense. That's not my concern, you know? But the work has been done all the time. The work has blossomed recently, you know, because of the consciousness with Junior Creole and things like that. Mm-hmm. But the work has been going on. And so that kind of work, consciousness-raising work, is not an easy thing. It's a slow, long, dogged process. But we are confident, you see, what we have already built is there. You cannot undo the consciousness that is there. You cannot undo that. That's already there. You cannot tell St. Lucia that they're no longer St. Lucian. You can no longer tell people about, well, you know, we finished with Junior Creole. You know? Mm-hmm. So what we have to do now is to involve, and we're going to do that at every point, at every step. We want the community, everybody. It's going to be public. Every discussion as to where we're going, public. Everybody must be involved in the decision making. So it's not just going to we meeting with government organ. No. It's the people saying what they want, where they want things to go, how they want things to be done. And you see, for us, that's a moral capital we have. That's a moral capital we have, you see. If people are saying what they want, it's not PABA, it's not FRC board, it's not anybody, it's the people. And let the people decide what our FRC becomes, where our FRC goes, how we do it, etc.
But you have to rationalize whatever decision, whatever recommendations will be coming from the people.
Sure.
What about getting outside assistance? This, what has happened to the FRC, this would have gone out to the rest of the world.
Precisely.
What about those relevant agencies
that initially were trying
to get assistance from
who
to digitize?
Reticent. Now again, we think that there's a... If you see the kind of response we've heard internationally, you know, what can we do? What can we do to assist? We say, fine. We appreciate your support, but now we're in the process of hearing from the people of St. Lucia what we want, what they want. Once we have the word from the people, then we can approach people. So in other words, we can have a mandate. And
so how soon are you hoping to get the final word from the people of St. Lucia?
Well, it's a process. For example, as we said, on Saturday, we're going to have this meeting with all FRC former members and
so forth.
Where
is that meeting taking place?
At the pastor, at the CDF, Cultural Development Foundation. We're having that from 10 o'clock on Saturday for the morning, right? That initial conversation will help us to see how are we going to go to the public discourse, because the following week, we want to have something for the public. So it can be at CDF grounds. We want to have a kind of open forum when everybody will come. And from then on, we'll take it on. We hope you'll invite us several times back on news. We'll go on all the media. I mean, it's a national discourse. The kind of thing that people talk about crime thing. We think it's greater than the crime issue, because we're talking about not crime is one aspect of St. Lucia. Culture is the heart of St. Lucia. So we want this to be a national discourse, constant going throughout everywhere. School level, children level, teachers level, you know, governmental level, private sector level, so all levels.
You're watching Newsmaker Live, and my guests this evening, Monsignor Patrick Anthony and also Mr. Eri LaForce, both of the Folk Research Center. When we come back, we'll take your calls, so please stay with us. Welcome back. Thank you so much for staying with us. You're watching Newsmaker Live right here on DBS Television. We put the telephone number on screen right now so that you can call with your questions and comments for my guests. Once again, Monsignor Patrick Anthony and Mr. Hilary LaForce, they're both from the Folk Research Center. And we're looking at the future of the FRC in the aftermath of the fire which destroyed the building last Sunday. We have our first call online. Hello, good evening. This is Newsmaker Live. You're on the air. Hello.
Good evening. Hi, hello.
Yes, hello.
Yes.
Yes, go ahead, please, caller.
All right. My question is, was there any kind of digital backup of some of the information or data that the FRC had in terms of cloud storage or electronic saving of the data?
Thank you so much for calling, ma'am.
Yes, some materials have been saved. But you see, our original stuff, like for example, things we had on pneumatic tapes and so forth, that's where we've been looking for the funding to digitize those things. Mm-hmm. Because these are not things you can send cloud like that, you have to digitize it. And it was very costly. This is why we had this proposal out to several agencies to try to do it. And people were not interested.
And you think now they're interested? Have they shown any interest in that since the fire?
Well,
you have nothing to digitize anyway.
Yes, we have. You see, don't forget, I said, we have a lot of material with our partner institutions, like University of Vienna, University of Indiana, Smithsonian, these places like that. Mm-hmm. So it means that we have to go and recoup. You see, that's what we did originally. We went outside, they searched, brought them to St. Lucia. So now we can try and see if we can recoup some of those stuff. Yeah.
We have a call. Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air. Hello.
For the sales and marketing department, please.
We lost that call. But continue to call us. Once again, the telephone number is on screen. And once again, my guests, Monsignor Patrick Anthony and Mr. Hilary LaForce of the Folk Research Center. I think we have another
call coming in. Good evening, what is your contribution caller?
Hi, good evening.
Hi, good evening to you, sir.
Like what continues and has always happened in St. Lucia, we do not miss something until it's gone. But tonight we can see through the valiant efforts of yourself and the persons who are there on the show tonight, we could see that St. Lucia culture is much alive, and the culture is really within us.
Precisely.
We, the people, are the ones who really showcase what it is that we are made out of and what we want other persons to see us as a country. Mm-hmm. So, like has been said by Father Anthony, you know, that whatever that has been destroyed can be rebuilt. And it is really us as a nation that needs to come together, that needs to come to the assistance of the FRC, probably bringing whatever we have that is of cultural value and importance to us as a people, to them, and we can rebuild. But one point that he spoke about, and I have always thought about this, when it comes to the aesthetics of the city of Castries, I really believe that much can be done, you understand? Mm-hmm. Where I will disagree with him is with that spot, Mont Pleasant, mm-hmm. where the FRC is located. I never knew where the FRC was located. Mm-hmm. And I believe a lot of St. Lucians did not know where that FRC is located, because it's not a building that you could see, you understand, that is viewable from any standpoint in St. Lucia.
Colin, if you don't mind me asking, where do you live?
Well, I live in Denry. I'm not from Castries. Oh. So that is one disadvantage already, that I didn't, you know, I know the city of Castries. I know points that I could see. I can see the Parliament buildings. I know where that is. Mm. I can see the National Cultural Center. That is a viewpoint that you could see from whatever point. You understand? Right. There are areas that you could see. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to the FRC building on Mount Pleasant, I think there's some trees that are blocking it.
Right.
But even I passed in that area and I tried to see the remnants of the building to see where it is, and I really couldn't see it. Mm-hmm. I was at the top of the hill there by, I think that's the right location, after you've left the funeral parlor. Mm-hmm. And
okay,
I tried to see if I could see the building in the back there, but I really couldn't see it in the bushes. So my humble suggestion is that the FRC, even though the administration building is located there, and is placed there, but to me, where that displays our national history, our artifacts, our you know, these elements, you know, should be placed somewhere that is viewable, that is somewhere that you can say, okay, that is the building. I can see it from that point in Castries. And one of the places that I believe is a wonderful place is where the Turning Point building used to be. I believe a nice building could be placed there, maybe call it the National Vault or something, you know, and have, you know, these artifacts of national cultural history placed there in glass. You know, that people can come there like a museum and look at these things, and it has the history about it. And I believe also it's not even only the city of Castries that should have that. Every community should have one house, one building, one, you know, even though it's not the same building, but a recreation of, you know, these old-time buildings, and have what is known in the community. I've always looked at even my community of Denry. Growing up, I've seen a lot of buildings that have just been left there to decay and mash up. And if you look at the style of these buildings, the French style of these buildings, you know, that is things that in other countries they would never let that happen to their buildings. They polish these buildings. If a termite infestation takes one plank, they restore it. You understand? They don't go painting and you know, just doing things reckless. There are buildings in the States and other places, you have to get approval to destroy it. You have to get approval to do different things to it, because it holds some sort of significant value. So I really wish in the rebuilding effort that can be taken into consideration. Maybe the area may not be as big as to create the same building in the Latok area, but a building that people can see and can know that is where, you know, national cultural artifacts are stored, and if, like the minister said, that if you have persons coming in and whatever, and you may need a bigger building that they could stay, that they could lodge in, maybe can be where the building currently was located.
But okay, all right, thanks a lot, caller. We're talking about suggesting more visibility, greater visibility.
Right, right, right. And you know, I think he's on point. And this was Tim, what we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this is FRC speaking there. That's FRC speaking there.
Yeah.
That's the kind of discourse we want. From the heart of St. Lucians, who understand the culture, who have a passion for the heritage, ideas, suggestion, direction.
Another call. Good evening. Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Hi, good evening.
Hi.
Good evening, Pablo.
Good evening.
And good evening, Mr. LaForce. My only thing is, I just joined the show, so I don't know if it was discussed earlier. But a matter of policy, I know we should rebuild, we should put the structure maybe as was before, but we need to develop strict policies that if somebody hands over an artifact, it must be digitized, it must be documented. You know, I don't know if you have discussed that before, but we need to put policies in place and the cost factor of who should pay for it.
Yeah.
I really believe the taxpayers of St. Lucia should be paying for stuff like that. This is ours.
Yeah.
I think it's our history, it's our culture. We don't need to decide on who is going to pay for it. I'm hoping that the government, you know, of St. Lucia, not the party, the government, should put a policy in place and put the budget in place to pay for things like that. So it's not just the building I'm worried about.
Right.
I'm worried about us, you know, just taking best practices from the Museum Association of the Caribbean, from
right,
different institutions
right,
of St. Lucia,
right,
and
right.
put together a policy that once you have a piece of artifact, it must be digitized, it must be documented, the history, and it must be stored in three places where if one is lost, you always have a backup. Thank
right,
you very
right.
much.
Thank you so much for calling, sir.
Good. Excellent suggestion.
Mm-hmm.
And again, we want to stress that, you see, FRC is not the only repository of artifacts and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, that we're just one our area's cultural heritage,
exactly.
But there are seven other different areas also. Though.
Another caller, 9. Good evening.
Yes.
Go ahead, please, caller.
Okay. Hi. Good evening,
all
Tim.
Right. There's a feedback, so take care of the television set, and then you can continue with your contribution, caller.
Okay.
Go ahead, please.
Good evening, Tim.
Hi. Good evening.
I just want to say good night to you and the FRC team.
Yes.
Good night.
Good night.
Indeed, it's a sad loss for St. Lucians. In St. Lucia, the diaspora everywhere. But I think it's a time. I already see this as the death of the old FRC, and it creates an emergence for the futuristic and the new FRC
absolutely.
To come alive.
Absolutely, absolutely.
I don't buy into the argument that digitalization is expensive. All you need is a $40 printer, a computer, an external drive. You're talking under $1,000 US and you're ready to go. Basically, it starts with the baby steps. So I absolutely don't buy that. But I think this is an opportunity for FRC to start to embrace technology, for our national institutions to start to embrace technology, and to make that connection between technology and documentation for generations and generations in the Caribbean we've been losing out on.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to table a simple idea. Very simple. Within the next 2 weeks, FRC should revamp its website, add on a cloud feature at the back end and open up a conversation and a call to St. Lucians at a community, national, regional, international level, diaspora, etc., to send, digitize whatever collections, memorabilia they have and send it to FRC.
Mm-hmm.
Let's begin the movement like that.
Mm-hmm.
We think in St. Lucia that we have to build a skyscraper to have a house.
Mm-hmm.
Let's start the movement that way.
Mm-hmm.
Involve the ICT Association of St. Lucia.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. It's simple. People think digitalization is complex. It's not, Tim. The prices are dropping every day on equipment and materials that you need to do that. So let's start the process, revamp the website, open up a call, have an email address where people can send in, put a descriptor in terms of 300 DPI resolution, send in whatever you have, photos, covers of books, whatever. Let's start. Thank you, Tim.
Where are you calling from, caller?
Castries.
Oh, Castries, okay.
Well, caller, we want to make an appeal to you. Mm-hmm. We're asking you come and see us because we want people like you to get involved and help us to do those things.
Yeah, it's simple. It's simple. Under 1,000 US, that's more than FRC's subvention budget, Papa.
Yeah. Yes, well, come forward. Okay. Eh? When we make all up, right. We're having our meeting on Saturday.
I'll be there.
Thanks a lot. Right.
Thank you very much. That's a very good solution and suggestion, in particular, the setting up of the revamping the website.
Yes.
Okay, we are waiting another call. Once again, you're watching Newsmaker Live right here on DBS Television. Good evening. You're on the air. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Hi. Good evening to you, sir.
Yes. The caller said that all you need is a scanner, blah, blah, blah. It depends on what you're digitizing.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
It depends on what.
Obvious,
if you have a large book, for example,
yeah.
Like these things that you record stuff from the you know, the courthouse and these places,
yeah.
Very large things.
Yeah.
You need a very large scanner for that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And that is expensive. It's not like you're buying a computer with a scanner to do that.
Yeah.
So sometimes it can be costly to do
digitizing.
Yeah, depending on what you want to do.
What do you want to do? Sure.
So it's not as simple as the caller says.
Yeah.
But she has a lot of bright ideas.
Oh yeah. Sorry. That's why we invite her, and we hope that all people like that come along. That's what we want now, you know?
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you so much. Appreciate your contribution, caller. Mm-hmm. Please, when you're calling, turn down the volume of your television set. Certainly that would prevent the echo and the feedback and all that. So we really don't want the feedback, but we want to hear what you have to say. We have another call. This is Newsmaker Live. Good evening. Hello. Okay, what was that call? But certainly you're getting some good recommendations coming from the callers. The suggestions.
That's the conversation we're talking about. That's what I say. The future is not us. It's the people. Those ideas, those suggestions. And particularly, we want to see, FRC has always been on voluntarism, you know? We want people to come forward and come and help us.
We have a call. Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Hi, good evening.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
Listen, the Catholic Church is the richest organization in the world. Why can't the Catholic Church inject money into the FRC? After all, it's named after Pablo himself. Isn't that a good point? Hey, listen, Pablo, take notes.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, Pablo, we'll see you. The ball is in your court.
If you
are on the program, you can defend yourself.
If you knew how poor the Catholic Church was in St. Lucia, you would never make that kind of suggestion.
Exactly.
You see, the economic hardships that are internationally affects the church. For example, simply, we used to be getting a lot of aid from, say, like the Germans, through German Catholics.
Mm-hmm.
When the Berlin Wall fell and East Germany came, all those resources that used to be coming to help countries like that went to help East Germany, you see? So the resources that were being, the Catholic Church was receiving from, depleted, you see? And of course, globally, we have all kind of issues, and even locally, our finances, we have a lot of serious problems. So it's not quite like you have a certain money you can just take and put in, you know? Mm-hmm. You know? Mm.
But the Catholic Church in Rome, very rich.
Mm? You see, people have this mythology about the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church in Rome is rich in terms of
artifacts,
you know, things like that. So the monetary value, but in terms of cash flow.
Yeah. You can sell some of the artifacts.
I'm sorry, we are not able to answer.
Let's see if we get another call. Once again, this is Newsmaker Live. And once again, my guest is Monsignor Patrick Anthony, founding member of the Folk Research Center. And also
Director,
Mr. Hilliforce.
Okay. Please dial
Mr.
Two.
Producer, we have some issue with the phone.
Hello?
So
please dial three.
We have something coming across on the line. Hello, good evening. Hello? Okay.
All right, so our producer will take care of that technical issue, and then let us see if we could get another contributor. And so far, we've been getting some good recommendations and suggestions coming from our callers. As the first consultation is taking place,
this is why, for me, although this has been such a painful experience, it is really a death and resurrection. You know, the kind of call we've been, you know how long we have been coming, let's discuss about it, let's help it. A few people coming, as you said,
yes,
a few members and so forth. Now we have this discourse and we're getting everybody, that's what we want, you know? So I think it's a powerful, very powerful experience and moment.
Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Good evening to you, you both.
Good evening to you, sir.
Father Anthony and Tim.
Good evening. And Mr. Hilary LaForce as well.
Oh, okay, yeah, and Hilary LaForce.
Yes.
Oh, actually, I'm Alexis Felix, architect.
Alexis. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
I was honored a few years ago. Well, it's about probably almost 10 years ago.
Yes, to that.
I prepared a concept.
Right.
For remodeling and expansion of the FRC building.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, actually, I have a CD with the drawings and
beautiful,
so on.
Beautiful,
and
beautiful.
For some reason, I cannot open the CD, you know, because you see, these days we don't use CDs that much.
Yeah,
That's how fast the technology has changed.
Right.
So I will have to try with some technician or something, some expert, to see if they can open it for me. But the only thing I have right now is an image, a JPEG of the front, you know, a 3D concept, like a perspective, you know, of the front.
Yeah.
I'm hoping that I can open this CD, you know.
And we hope with the call we're making now that people who are in the technology will come and assist us in that. And also, to you see, Alexis, your proposals, we had sent out to several funders, so we can actually go back to them and try to retrieve that, yes.
All right.
Okay, thank you so much for calling, sir. This is Newsmaker Live. We have about 10 minutes left on the program, so we'll be taking as many calls as possible. Once again, for my two guests on the program, Mr. Hilary LaForce, Executive Director of the FRC, and founding member of the FRC, Mr. Monsignor Patrick Anthony. Let's see if we have another caller line. Hello, good evening, you're on the air. Hello. Okay, we lost this call. So let us see if we can get another call to come in. Good evening. All right. But clearly a lot of good is coming out of this particular process.
Yeah.
We're just hoping that nonetheless that you'll be getting greater, the support will continue in the weeks and even months ahead. But you'll have to muster the energy, the courage to continue, because it will take a lot, I'm sure.
Yeah, I think you see, the passion of people are energizing us.
Yes.
It's energizing us. I mean, some of those suggestions we had tonight, brilliant, absolutely brilliant.
Yeah.
You know, if you can get people to come forward and let's discuss it, let's discuss it. So when we talk, we're not just talking from our heads, we're talking from the ideas that's outside in St. Lucia, you know.
Exactly.
And this is only St. Lucia. I mean, we're not even going to the diaspora yet.
Yeah.
You know, that dialogue outside there too. So I think there's a tremendous amount of hope. We're very, very hopeful.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But have you set a time frame within which you want to? And I know you're talking about dialoguing,
we,
consultation with the people and so on.
Our St. Lucia conference is in June.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So we want this period between now, the St. Lucia conference, in which we're going to build not just the FRC, but archives has to be part of that.
Mm-hmm.
And its society, all the members, trust, all the institutions involved in the protection, gathering of the data, we want them all to be involved in it. So after that, we can get a mandate with which we can now go and face funders in the name of not just of FRC, but the global kind of approach.
We have a call. Good evening. Hello.
Yes, good night.
Hi, good night to you, caller.
Yes, now that this unfortunate event has occurred and the property at Mount Pleasant has been burned down, would there be any pressure placed on the FRC to actually just abandon that property and maybe move to a smaller one, you know, because someone might have some idea that probably that can be used for some other, you know, you know, activity or some other, you know, purpose.
Okay, well,
thank you so much for calling, sir.
Good question. Part of FRC, part of the property belongs to FRC. Mm-hmm. The wider property does not belong to FRC. In fact, that's why FRC is trying to acquire it. So we have no sort of control over the wider property, but we know we have part of ours. But however, we are pushing the concept of the vision that we had of acquiring the entire property to do the sort of things we wanted to do. But again, as I say, all of that at this point now is in the public domain for solutions, ideas, suggestions to us, what they think should be happening, how we should go. That's out there for you, public. We want your ideas, your suggestions, what you think should happen, what should be done.
Okay, but you, as I think I'd ask you the question earlier about the time frame. You're looking at a particular time frame.
Yeah, so we're looking between now and the conference, which are already planned in June. That conference should be the place where we bring together all of those ideas, get proposals, get
example. Okay, I think we have another caller. Producer, do we? Hello, Newsmaker Live? Okay, we do not have a call. But how do you hope to bring in more people into the fold? Into the fold of the Folk Research Center, because you're telling me, Mr. LaForce, that you have at least only 20 something members.
Yeah.
You would be taking the opportunity within the next few weeks to ensure that you increase the numbers. Let's take a call. Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Hello, good evening. What will become of
Welcome
Happy?
Welcome to Down Here Podcast.
What will become of?
Happy.
Oh, Happy. Okay. That's a very good question.
Yes.
Oh, it'll be difficult to get Happy out of the FRC area. This dog is so used to that building and to the entire environment that we're thinking, how could we get this dog out of there? Currently, we cannot. We don't have the space to have it. But the dog is so used to us, and I feel sorry for it, you know, every time I get out there.
Yeah. You have another call. Good evening.
Yes, good evening.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
Yeah, when I was last at the FRC in January, actually it was for a lecture by Dr. Claire Robertson. On St. Lucia's history. I know you all had artifacts, including some old traditional irons, and some things made of maybe clay.
Right.
And would there be any attempt, once a forensic investigation of the site is complete, to actually try to salvage, you know, iron, you know, artifacts, you know, because they probably would have survived the actual, you know, inferno.
You know, actually, caller.
Thank you so much for calling, sir.
one of the fantastic symbols of this whole thing is that all the clay pots are right there. You see, when the clay pots were built in the furnace, in the fire. Mm-hmm. So the clay pots have resisted and they're there. So, and for me, that's a symbol of FRC, you know, that, you know, through the crucible of this agony, this fire, that we resilient, our chairperson.
Yes, it was
she was about resilience. FRC, this whole experience has brought out, you know, we are resilient people. St. Lucians are resilient people. That's one of the values that FRC has discovered. Like Kudman, so resilience. And that's resilience is what these clay pots symbolize. And we will survive.
We hope to put this pot into a museum where persons can remember what happened at FRC and the survivor of FRC, basically.
Let's take a final call. Good evening. This is Deus Mikalive. You're on the air.
Yes, good evening. I have a funny comment.
Yes, go ahead.
The first thing you need wherever you're going to relocate is a no smoking sign, because it takes one match that did not go off to set somebody to call somebody who is smoking to set a whole building on fire.
Mm.
So you can put one building in the north, one in the south, whatnot. We have to have the place secured from no smoking.
Okay, thank you.
And
another thing, it's pointless like having a special building for things like that. You all have to think more of duplication of the work, or triplication, whatever you want to call it.
Mm.
So when you have something that you receive for one place, you try and have extra expenditure to have a copy for about three other places or so. Because you go onto another building and there can be a fire.
Mm. yeah,
put it somewhere else again, there can be a fire.
Mm.
But when you have things duplicated or triplicated, you lose in one place. Nothing is lost because you have the same features elsewhere. This is my conclusion.
Thanks a lot, dear.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Final comments, let's start with you, Mr. LaForce.
Okay, well, the pain is still there. The pain of the fire, the loss. We were debriefed this morning, and to a certain extent, you know, I'm getting back to my normal self. But this afternoon, for example, there was a visit to the place by our children, our after-school children. I didn't want to go. I didn't want to see the place anymore for now. I'm thinking if I might go there, it brings back the memories of the sadness. But in time, with time, it will cure. And we're hoping that has given us that resilience as we're using, and that drive to continue FRC as a people, not only the building, but that movement of persons understanding the culture. Is not purely about the various Creole dances and so on. It's about our way of life, our people, our identity. We'll continue to champion, to advocate for persons to continue burning the fire.
Monsignor Patrick Anthony.
Yes, when Sir John helped us acquire that property, it was on the international market, and there were several persons interested. And when I was alerted to that, and I went to Sir John, and I said to him, Sir John, you know the work we've been at FRC, it's the future, it's for the children of St. Lucia. And we think that location should be for the children of St. Lucia. And Sir John said, absolutely. And he's going to, and he gave us, he kick-started it, and every government since has helped us to acquire the property. So I think that there is this understanding that FRC is about the children, about the future. So for us, FRC is in the heart of St. Lucians, because we have to pass on to our children our memory, our knowledge, our experience, our values, and that is FRC's work. So a building. And we have to learn from all the experiences. We have to do all kinds of things. We have to learn that. But I'm saying that every St. Lucian must understand that FRC is within them. When we started off, we went to St. Lucians and spoke to St. Lucians and got things from St. Lucians. St. Lucians are still alive. We can go to St. Lucians, get things again. But it is to pass on to our children, so that they can know their stories, that they can know what all the ancestors have done. They can understand the creativity. They can understand the genius of those who have gone before, and then they can discover their own good potentiality. So for me, FRC is in the heart of every St. Lucian, and FRC is alive. And we want to invite you again to join us in this conversation. We want you to determine what FRC becomes, where it go, what happens with FRC. That you are FRC.
Senior Patrick Anthony, thank you so much for being my guest, as well as Mr. Ariel LaForce. And during the first segment, we had Juliana Prosper. Thank you so much for being part of the program. As always, thank you so much for watching, and thank you so much for contributing via your calls. If it's Wednesday, it's Newsmaker Live. Time now for the clip that peaked.
Any comment I'm getting on cheese red cheese by phone? What's that cheese I got sorty? Where's that cheese coming from? Say something, I got sorty. Come on, that cheese red, cheese by my red. By phone, what's up? The wash the bull red. La mat red. No, come on, that cheese red. Why? Say, Bioga, what's up?
Once again, that's a broadcast. My name is Timothy Paulion, saying good night and see you next time.